we will start with the enamel. Enamel is the hardest calcified tissue in the body, which is developed from the specialized cells called as the ameloblast. Now they form the resistant covering of the enamel, as it is consist of highly mineralized structure and which is resistant, and it bears a maximum masticatory load. The physical characteristics of enamel. The thickness of the enamel is variable. Now the maximum thickness of enamel is about 2 to 2.5 millimeter on the cusp of the human molars and premolars, and at the neck of the tooth it is 9 inch. It is hardest calcified tissue, at the same time it is brittle. The specific gravity of the enamel is 2.8, and it is semi-permeable membrane. So it allows only the, it allows or permits the certain molecules to pass through it. The color of the enamel is either yellowish white to grayish white, and it depends upon the translucency of the enamel. The chemical properties of the enamel. The enamel consists of 96% of inorganic material and 4% of organic material and water. The inorganic material is in the form of hydroxyapatite crystals, and these crystals appear hexagonal in cross section. The organic material is basically protein and lipids. The unique proteins which are found in the enamel are amylogenins, which makes up the major portion, that is 90%, and amylogenin, non-amylogenins, that is 10%. So amylogenins are rich in proline, histidine, glutamine, and leucine, and they are low molecular weight. Why? The non-amylogenins, they are rich in enamelin, amyloblastin, tophtalin, and they are high molecular weight proteins. Now we'll see the structure of the enamels. The enamel consists of enamel rod, rod sheath, and interrod substance. Enamel rods, it is also called as prisms. So the number of enamel rods, they are 5 million in the lower lateral incisor to 12 million in the upper first molar. They follow the wavy course or tortuous course, and the diameter of each enamel rod is 4 micrometer. Now this diameter increases from the dentine enamel junction to the surface of the enamel at the ratio of 1:2. So these enamel prisms, they appear as a segmental rods in longitudinal section and a fish scale in cross section. Now in this slide you can see this is an enamel rod. This is the head of the enamel rod and tail of the enamel rod. And this appears oval or fish scale in cross section. Now, some of the structures, many structures of the enamel rod, they are beyond the resolution of the light microscope, and they can be best visualized in electron microscopy. So, the common pattern of the enamel rod is keyhole or paddle shape. When we cut it longitudinally, the section passes through the heads or bodies of one row and rods and tails of an adjacent row. So, this each rod is surrounded by rod sheath and separated by interrod substance. And each rod measures about 5 micrometer in breadth and 9 micrometer in length. The bodies of the rods are nearer to the occlusal and incisal surface, and tails point cervically. Now the orientation of the crystal. The crystals are oriented parallel to the long axis of their bodies or heads, and they deviate about 65 degrees from the axis they as they fan out into the tails. The average thickness of the crystal is about 30 nanometer, and an average width is about 90 nanometer. Now next, the striations of the enamel. Now here in this picture you can see that each enamel rod is built up of the segments, which is separated by a dark lines that give it as a striated appearance. Now this is because the enamel matrix, it is formed in a rhythmic way. Now the length of each segment or rod is segment is 4 micrometer, and this is because of the diurnal rhythm in rod formation. Next is direction of the enamel rods. Now here in this picture you can see the direction of the enamel rods in deciduous and the permanent dentition. Usually the enamel rods, they are right angled to the dentine surface. In deciduous teeth, in the cervical third and middle third, the enamel rods, they are horizontal. While in the occlusal third, they run obliquely until they are almost vertical in the region of the edge or tip of the cusp or at the incisal edge. In case of permanent teeth, the arrangement of the direct enamel rods is same in the cuspal region as well as in the middle occlusal one third and middle one third, but it varies in the cervical one third, where the rods, they deviate from horizontal in an apical direction, that is rootward. The next structure is gnarled enamel. In some areas of enamel close to the dentino enamel junction, especially in the region of cusp. Now in this slide you can see the enamel rods, they are arranged more complexly and they are intertwined. Now this appearance or optical appearance is called as a gnarled enamel. Now it is, suppose it is related to the increased strength of the enamel. So next is Hunter-Schicker band. Now these Hunter-Schicker bands, they are alternate light and dark bands. Now you can see these are the dark bands, light bands, dark bands, light bands. Now dark bands, they are called as diazones, while light bands, they are called as parazones. Now this appearance of these Hunter-Schicker bands is because of the change in the direction of the enamel rods. This is a functional adaptation, and in longitudinal section, they are best visualized in ground section under oblique reflected light. The angle between the diazone and parazone is about 40 degrees. Now these rods, as you can see here, they in the outer third of the enamel, the rod do not bend, and therefore these bands, they are absent in the outer third of the enamel. Incremental lines of red CS. Now here in this picture you can see the arrow indicates the incremental lines. These are the brownish bands in the ground section of the enamel, and they indicate the successive opposition of the layers of enamel. They denote the rest periods between the periods of activity, and in cross section they appear concentric, and they run obliquely from dentino enamel junction to the surface. So these are all these incremental lines of red CS. Now these incremental lines, they have been attributed to the periodic bending of the enamel rods, to variation in the basic organic structure, or to the physiologic calcification rhythm. So this all are the incremental lines. Next is enamel lamellae. They are the leaf-like structures which run from the enamel surface towards the dentinal enamel junction. There are three types. Usually these enamel lamellae, they develop in the planes of tension. So there are three types, type A, type B and type C. So type C is the more common. Type A and type B, they reach up to the dentine, and type C usually it crosses the dentino enamel junction. So type C is more common. Type A and type B. Type A is filled with the poorly calcified rods. Type B is filled with the degenerated cells, and type C with the organic matter derived from the saliva. So type C is the more common. Now it is a site of weakness, and it forms the road of entry for the bacteria, and that initiate the caries. That is the clinical significance of the enamel lamellae. So type A and type B, they are usually produced during the enamel formation, and type C is produced after eruption. Next is enamel tufts. Here in this picture you can see these are the tufts of the grass which are viewed in the ground section. So this resembles duct of the grass arising from the dentino enamel junction. So they reach into the enamel about 1/5 to 1/3 of its thickness. They are called enamel tufts. They consist of hypocalcified enamel rods and interprismatic substance. And they are abundantly seen in horizontal section. And now the presence of and development of this enamel tuft is a consequence of an adaptation to the special condition in the enamel. Next is enamel spindles. Enamel spindles are actually the extensions of the odontoblastic process into the enamel, and they are thickened at their end. They are hypomineralized areas and found mainly in the cusp of teeth region. Dentino enamel junction. Here in this diagram you can see the surface of the dentine at the dentino enamel junction is pitted. Now into the shallow pits, depressions of dentine fit the rounded projections of the enamel, and this relation assures the firm hold of the enamel cap on the dentine, and this appears as a scalloped line. So here you can see the dentino enamel junction is scalloped. Neonatal line. This is accentuated incremental line of red GS, which is denoting the prolonged period of rest during the birth. And the enamel of the deciduous teeth develops partly before and partly after the birth. So the enamel which develops before the birth and the enamel which develops after the birth is separated by a darkly brownish line that is called as a neonatal line. Now this appears due to the abrupt change in the environment and nutrition of the newborn infant. The prenatal enamel which is formed is of a brighter quality than the postnatal enamel. Here the arrow indicates the neonatal line. author can say this. It is seen in all deciduous teeth and in first permanent molars only. Now, apart from this, there are different surface structures. The prismless enamel is seen in 70% of permanent teeth. Now, this structureless layer of enamel, it is usually 30 micrometer teeth, and it is seen in all deciduous teeth and maximum in 70% of permanent teeth. It is commonly found over the cusp teeth and cervical areas. Now, the surface structures, this prismless enamel is heavily mineralized than the rest bulk of the enamel beneath it. So there are other structures like perichymata. These are the transverse wave-like grooves, and they are nothing but the external manifestations of the striae of Retzius. They are continuous around the tooth and they lie parallel to each other and to the cemento enamel junction. There are 30 perichymata per millimeter near the cemento enamel junction. So apart from this, there are again surface structures like enamel caps, enamel brooch, and pits are seen. So cracks are also seen. These are narrow fissure-like structures. Enamel cuticle. Now, a delicate membrane called as Nasmyth's membrane or primary enamel cuticle, which covers the entire crown of the newly erupted tooth. Now, this primary enamel cuticle, it is soon removed by the mastication. Now, this electron microscopic study indicates that this is typical basal lamina, which is secreted by the ameloblast when enamel formation is complete. Now, function is to protect the surface of the enamel from the resorptive activity of the adjacent vascular tissue prior to the eruption of the tooth. Now, this erupted enamel is normally covered by a pellicle, which is nothing but the precipitate of a salivary protein.